Dear friends, Savrashakar here again, and we are now in the 13th of the lecture on especially about my concepts, about what Jaimini Sutras or Upadesha Sutras are trying to tell us and how I would interpret it. Though, as I have always, repeated umpteen number of times, many astrological greats have done it in their own way. I may be wrong, I might be right, you have to decide. So now we go for, see, we are seeing. We saw what happens in Karakausha, then what happens about the second bhava, second from the Karakausha, when Tatra is used, which could be second house. Then we went to the fourth from the Karakausha, where indications are about the fourth house, the houses that the Jataka will build or occupy or live in, and so on. And now we go to the, if I may say, one of the interesting houses that every young man and woman wants to know more about, which is the 7th house representing spouse of the Jataka. To my mind, it is basically the bond between Jataka and somebody from opposite sex usually. In the modern days, it could be same-sex marriages, but I would not like to comment on it. But this being a science from an ancient age, it generally looks at. See, you have to remember that if something is being said for X sex, it also applies to the Y sex. So here you will find the name Sundari, that is always the female is indicated, but it would also be male for a female Jataka's chart. So this one must understand. So the first sutra goes like Labhe Chandra Grubhyam Sundari. Not very difficult to understand for those who understand Hindi or Marathi or even Sanskrit. And for English, Labhe is, as you know, with the Katapayadi, it means the 7th. Ya, Ra, La is 3. So, Pa, Fa, Bha, Si, So, so reverse it, divide by 12, and what you get is 7. So, I'm sure that is clear. And so, Chandra Guru Bhyam Sundari, if in the 7th from Karakamsha, Moon and Jupiter occupy our aspect, then this spouse will be beautiful or handsome, depending on the sex of the spouse. This is pretty easy to understand. Moon is supposed to be beautiful and Jupiter is the knowledgeable one, and people look at a person's either knowledge or beauty, and so that is not very difficult. Next comes Rahuna Vidhava. Rahu, the north node of the, moon, aspecting or occupying the 7th from the Karakamsha, would indicate that the person will marry a widow. Would it necessarily be widow? I would say, Rahu takes, the strength from somebody else and then gives on to you, so it may be the one who has already been married and married again is one, but then Rahu has many meanings, including foreigners, those of lower caste, according to the Jataka's family, and anybody who is unusual, researcher, all those things would also come. This is my opinion. The sage says only Vidhava. You don't see those many people marrying widows all the while, or widowers all the while, and we must apply our brain, is how I look at the science. I am sure now we are into, I think, 89th or 90th lecture of the series, and you must know how I think about things. I look at whether this really happens with that much frequency, because there are only 8 grahas, because Ketu is rarely talked about, but 9 grahas at the most that will come into picture, and statistically that is not the number we get, so we expand it. Even in the Chandra Gurubhyam, it could be somebody who is fair or with a yellowish tinge in the color, but not perhaps black, and with a round face, that is the moon, and guru maybe a bit stout. So this is how we should understand. We understand the I'm talking about the sutras and simultaneously giving you something else. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. This is no aspersion on any commentator, because they have very faithfully commented upon the sutras. They have tried to unravel it in their own ways. Next comes Shani. Shanina Vayodhika Vayodhika is one who is more in age. And then he says Rogini Tapasviniva. Either the spouse is maybe elder than the Jataka. I would also include being mature than the Jataka, not only age, because Vayodhika is complex. Even Vruddha, when we say, we also say Jnana Vruddha and Vayovruddha. Somebody who is old, if you can call it that, but one who has acquired much knowledge is also called Vruddha. As we say, see, in the Vruddha Karikas, they were not old men, they were knowledgeable persons. And also, some people are mature by age. So, Shanina, Vayodhika, Rogini. Sometimes Saturn does represent, we know, a lame person or somebody who maybe may have chronic diseases. Saturn gives anything for a long time. He is Karaka for Dukkha, the sorrow. So generally his type of diseases are, as you know, the arthritis, asthma and all those things are long-term diseases. So the sage says Rogini. This would also apply to the male, if the spouse is male. Tapasviniva, or somebody who is, somebody who undergoes tapas, as you say, I think the English people understand tapas, but tapas is also, you know, putting oneself to great, how can I call it? In great difficulty or work very hard to attain something. Now that something is usually connected with, when we say tapasvini, the formless form of the god, because Saturn is, you know, it is a planet which is actually not only called aerial planet, it is actually a gaseous planet. So the sages knew much more about astronomy and the nature of the planets without having any Hubble telescope or anything of the sort with them. We must respect that. So this is what it is saying. Saturn is a thinker, he is a deep thinker, and so Tapasvini is naturally that person can also be contemplating on various aspects of life, including what it means to be married, and then could sometimes become a renunciate. We see this in Stri Jataka, when Saturn alone in the ninth house is indicative of a woman especially being a renunciate. That is one of the Pravajna Yogas. So now we have completed Saturn, you know. So these are according to the nature of the planets which are influencing or occupying the seven from the Karakamsha. Now here it is very obvious that Karakamsha Rashi is being treated as if it is Lagna. Same thing happens when these planets aspect the Lagna, I mean the seventh from the Lagna also, aspect or occupy or influence. Here of course the Rashi Vrushtis are used. Then he says Pujena Vikalangi. If Mars is so connected or influencing, aspecting or occupying the seventh from the Karakamsha, what happens is, see, he has some bodily weakness. We can say physically challenged. But that would not always be the case. See, Mars, you know, is the fighter and somebody who wants to, you know, with the seventh, he will be very active. So there is possibility of some harm to the body of the spouse. I am sure all of you remember that if Mars aspects the Lagna, the ascendant, then there could be some mark of or injury on the face or head of the Jataka. Obviously, same will happen to the seventh from Karakamsha if Mars aspects or occupies it. So it's not very difficult to understand where the logic is going, and so as I also go on reading it and trying to interpret it, I find that, yeah, here perhaps the Karakamsha Rashi, the Navamsha Rashi occupied by the Charakaraka as seen in the Lagna chart and distances from it could also be telling us something. And so you should try it out on real life chart and find out. And then Ravina Swakule Gupta Cha. Now this Cha many a times also means, could mean, not only Mars but Sun should also influence, or Sun could independently influence. So it could be the Cha could be Swakule and Gupta, or Cha could relate to the Kujena Vikalani. I would think it would generally be Ravina Swatule, Gupta, Swatula and Gupta. So what is Swatula is her own family, generally protected by the family, and Gupta Cha. Or her family is not known, so she could be an adopted daughter or whatever. This is also a possibility. This is interpreted in different fashion. Some say that she will be attached to her own family and somebody else, as the one of the Uddhakarika says, Ravina Svakunere Gupta Asakta Paravaishmani. So if son is connected with the influencing, either by occupation or by aspect, on the seventh bhava from the Karakamsha, the lady is more attached to different people's houses. Veshma is house, as you know, para is others, and this has many meanings, and so this is one of the Vruddhakarika. What he is saying is, she is asakta, she is attracted to others' houses, could also mean, but not necessarily always. So remember that, don't jump to conclusions. It is also possible that she might be attached to somebody else. Need not necessarily be an affair. Sometimes people get attached to other family, not necessarily for sexual reasons. So remember this, because there is a tendency I have seen in the modern day astrologers just to jump to conclusions and declare somebody infidel or whatever. Please don't do it. Check it at many places, especially the 5th and 9th house. If they are strong, maybe the feeling could be there, but this would not actually convert into something tangible on ground. So please remember this. Sometimes maybe I will talk about Chandra again and try to explain what I feel about all these things, how those charts operate and what happens. Then the next one says Buddha. Buddha is Mercury. Budhena Kalavati. If Mercury occupies all aspects, Rashi aspects, obviously we are talking about the Charakarakavsha and other things, and especially we are talking about Upadesha Sutras, who are focusing on a particular area, and where they always talk only about the Rashi Drushti, not the Graha Drushti. So then she would be an artist. Why artist? Perhaps because Mercury is able to grasp everything very fast, and maybe whatever she sees, she might be able to grasp the essence or the beauty of things or something, because ultimately the seventh bhava in the natural zodiac happens to be a house of Venus, and Venus himself or herself, whatever way, I mean, because he is also called as a Sri Karaka Graha, though referred to as a male planet in astrology, Vedic astrology. So but in Western astrology, maybe they would call Venus a she. It doesn't make any difference. Planets do not have any sex. They indicate certain things. So, naturally, somebody with a great grasp of situation, instant grasp of situation, occupying a Rashi or a Bhava, which is a natural Karaka for Venus, the one who is artistic, could be an artist herself. I think this is the logic behind that sutra. Then whatever, we are finding that Venus is strangely missing from this. And then we again go to the Vruddhakarikas, where one Vruddhakarika says, Shukrena tadvat neya. Neya means know or understand, and tadvat means similarly to Buddha. Nirvishanka Dvijottama. Oh great of his prime minister, without doubt you can say, if Venus is there, he will also be, the spouse will be Kalavati, an artist. Kalavati is a female, of course, gender in Sanskrit and other Indian languages, but here you can understand that even if it is a, I mean, if the spouse is male, then the this is talking more about the spouse than about the sex of the spouse. And this is how it operates. And then the last one is a bit complex sutra. Its interpretation is a bit different, and I will try to tell you what I think about it. You may accept it, you might not, because most of the commentators have interpreted it to mean something else. So it is Chandrayana Vritte Deshe. So Chandrayana means by Chandra. Anana Vritte means Anavritte Deshe. So Chape, it says Chape Chandrayana Anavritte Deshe. So this has been interpreted by all the great ones from Nilkantha onwards to the most modern ones, as that person will have quite us with his spouse for the first time in open space. The problem is, why should it? I mean, suddenly this is sutra, is it? So sutras are always, they follow a thread, a particular thread of thought, is it? After this, the sage goes to the Dvadasha Bhava and Nayan Bhava and all those bhavas, as you will see as we go ahead in the sutras. So why suddenly this guy should have coitus in a different area? This is something which has made me think 10 times about what is being said. So I went through the anavrutta, of course, certainly means uncovered in a way, but there is another meaning, that is not returning. See, not returning to the fourth bhava, that is the house of the Jataka, because this is following anyway the those seven bhavas there. Prior to that, there was something about the fourth bhava, we were looking at it, and so maybe the sutra came later on, perhaps somebody, you know, somewhere or other, while transcribing it in written form, somebody made a mistake and that sutra was taken later on. That is possible, there is some logic to it. And anavrutta is not returning back. And if you think about it, you will find if moon aspects the fourth house, even in the regular chart, then what happens is this person is constantly away from his home. He has a tendency to. Will he be? I'm not sure. But he will like to be away from the home. He will be changing his profession, even maybe his career at graduation time will be going up and down, we have seen that. And so this not returning to home again and again could fit this better. And Deshe is also country. Deshe also means his own place. So this is not talking about, certainly not talking about the spouse. This is talking about something else, and perhaps the order of the sutras has changed. This is my opinion. You try it out on charts that you see. You see whether moon aspecting the fourth from the Karakamsha for the Jataka whom you know very intimately, because this is a question which is a bit awkward to ask somebody, and find out what happens. But you will certainly find out that he is many a time disturbed being at home. So he would be fond of, you know, traveling around or changing work or even changing his performance at the graduation level, which is represented by the fourth bhava, would be going up and down. See, this is what I think. So my dear friends, here I think I should close this, because as we always see, our time limit not exceeding 20 minutes, though I sometimes do it, and I hope I am not boring you. But you think about it, why should moon connected with the fourth house make one have quarters in open field? I mean, I could understand if I mean, if fourth house is treated to be happiness and coitus itself is supposed to be the greatest happiness, then I could understand by the side of a water body or river or whatever, you will find such a, you know, sort of, you know, yogas, perhaps in Varaha Mira as Brahajataka, if memory serves me right, where moon is connected with birth in water or whatever. So in water means it would never be in water. Anyway, any body is always in the amniotic fluid, so it is always in a fluid before the birth takes place. But it may be while traveling on some ship or some boat or something like that, it's quite possible. And so this is a sutra where I would like all the great researchers in Jaimini astrology and those who want to know more about it and find out whether it really applies to real life charts, find out what happens with this sutra. Chandrenama Vrutta Deshe Cha Pe Chandre. So cha is, I mean, now you know everything actually. So So 6 is cha. Pa is the first one. 16 rivers divide. So find out what happens. I repeat, I don't mean to belittle any of the commentators, starting right from the great Neelakantha to Balakrishnananda Saraswati to Achyutananda Jhaji and K.N. Rao sir, my friend Sanjay Rath, and many others, Dr. Kurekar of Nagpur, and I'm sure there would be many more who have done work on this, but I would enjoin upon you, if you really want to know and know more about the how to interpret and apply Jaimini or Upadesha Sutras to real life chart, to undertake this research on this one sutra itself. And I would be very, what can I say, grateful if someone gives me feedback on this. So my friends, I won't take more of your time and shall say good night to you and thank you.